This, the next match in the wheelchair rugby. Great Britain taking on Canada. And Canada, the host nation, is their victory that they record in their opener in day one. They look good, but both of those teams playing an exciting brand of wheelchair rugby as they good, well, they give as good as they got, really, in that one. But you see the scoreline. Canada ultimately beating Brazil by those 14 points. And then Australia in their opener take on Great Britain. They win by two. So an interesting group shaping up here. The Australians are the reigning gold medal champions from London 4 years ago. And that is quite the outfit, as the Canadians were beaten in the gold medal final. So are they good enough to go on to gold, though, in this turn for the Rio Paralympic Games, the Canadians? Well, this will be a big indication, because Great Britain at those host games in London, they finished fifth, and they may be just scheduled, the way this tournament is shaping out at the moment, to maybe be just outside that semifinal round. It's a must-win game for both teams, as you look at the Australian and the American in charge, Liam Costello and Mitch Carr, the two referees. But in a short tournament of two teams, or two groups of four, eight teams total in the entire bracket, these three games they play in the preliminary round effectively are setting the table. And so a victory already for Canada, a defeat already for GB. In game two, it makes it a must-win game already for Great Britain. As we look at the Canadian team in black with red, they will come out first, and that is Travis Murao. Ian Cham will follow him, and there you see him. And Biletsky is the lady there at the front, number one. She's the first ever female in wheelchair rugby to participate in a gold medal final at the World Championships. That was in 2014, and that was in Denmark, as the entire squad is going to be introduced here. There you see the names on the banner. The veteran WILLSIE, number 14, right on through. MADELL gets upended, and MADELL always with a smile on his face. He is a superstar in the sport, number 33 there. There's their long-tenured coach, Kevin Orr, who led this side to silver. They've been battling in this sport at the top echelons really since the start of it, when it was initially brought into the Paralympic manifold. That was in Sydney in 2000. Great Britain have been in and amongst it as well, and they have designs to get to that medal game. They're going to have to go through these North Americans, though, and they know it, as Jim Roberts just announced coming out. And now you're seeing Alan Ash back in this national program. He missed the London Paralympic Games, but has been returned in. There is Jim Roberts. That is their most notable threat in this lineup, number nine, who is going to do the scoring. He, in his opener, records 27 goals for Great Britain in that matchup against the Americans. So providing, well, more than half of the output. They also have a female player. There you see, as the number 23. It's Coral Batey, who is the female player for Great Britain. And there their coach, Paul Shaw, a veteran of this GB side as well. But for now, it's the playing of the national anthems for both nations. this a matchup to really separate teams that want to be and are good enough to be in the semifinal round. Really, that's what it ultimately comes down to. Doesn't matter at what sport and what level you're playing, there are the dividing points, and this matchup coming up between these two Commonwealth countries will divide who really, ultimately, I believe, is going to go into the semifinal. Of course, I'm preempting things. There are 3 days of preliminary play. This is just the second day of competition. But these athletes, they know just how important Great Britain to respond in this one. They're not expecting that the Australians are going to fall in their matchups, but this is sport. Things can happen. As you see, both Kevin Orr and Paul Shaw have got their sides assembled and ready. They're as ready as they're ever going to be. They have the second service, really, the second chapter of focus at these Paralympic Games. They don't start until late because it is such a short tournament. The two groups of eight. And as we say, well, there is Ayaz BHUTA. He needs to be a strong player to present. Mandip Semi is also a veteran of this British side. But they need to bring the noise in this one, Great Britain. So much reliant upon Roberts in the opening matchup against the Australians. And they're just going to have to be much stronger today as an entire group all the way through their lineup. That's the Canadians. That is Byron Green. Didn't get activity in their opener, but the Canadians generally do a pretty good job with balance throughout their lineup and distributing the scoring. But their real threat, their world-class player that's right at the top of his game, is a 22-year-old, Zak Male. He is number 33 in this lineup, as you're looking at one of the captains there. That is Patrice Simard, one of the long-standing players. BILETSKI, as we say, is the first ever lady to participate in a world championship gold medal match. And it is actually officially HIRSCHFIELD and DAGENAIS with the co-captaincy for this Canadian side. When you look at Great Britain all the way through the lineup, you've got it's number 9, Jim Roberts, and then Ayaz BHUTA. Mandip Semi also ready to do duty today. Jamie Stead, a handy player, number 12 and 22 as well. Chris Ryan, capable of shouldering the load. And Shaw, a participant, a player of wheelchair rugby all the way up until those games in Beijing, and then not a part of it, watching from the sidelines in 2012, those host Paralympic Games. For Canada, their lineup, Chan, a veteran, right back to Sydney. WILLSIE, a veteran of the side, number 14. He wears, well, he's 48 years of age, so he wears 14. And then, of course, Zak Male, 33 is his number, 22 years of age. Kevin Orr, what a signature name that is. Orr as a surname in Canada. As this the opening lineup for Great Britain, COGGAN, Walker, Roberts, and BHUTA. They will get it started for the mother country of Great Britain. BILETSKI, Whitehead, HIRSCHFIELD, the captain, MADELL, the duties, the four to start. We're just awaiting the opening tip-off here inside the Carioca number 1 arena. The officials in place. The fans are loud. All of the ingredients now for what will be a little bit of a heated affair. It's going to be Whitehead who takes it down. He is the big, powerful Canadian. He moves it up to Madell, and right away you're seeing that 1-2 punch that they go to. Whitehead, who has that strength, he's got that height to be able to extend for the ball, and he'll just release Madell. Madell is a roadrunner. Basically, against anybody in the world, you'd throw him in a matchup, and I'm still debating who I think is the quickest between Riley Batt, number 3 in Australia, and equally what we saw last night from Braz in the first matchup for Brazil. But this will be Roberts who scores for Great Britain. So these two opening scores belong to the biggest scores most likely in this matchup. So day 2 of the wheelchair rugby. And the release pass into Whitehead in the central position. So he occupies really the middle of this floor, of this field. He's got to be careful not to go over that center line. The over and back call would be called against him as Madell, he fights off a couple of British players and then he takes it across the goal line. So inside that 8-meter distance between the 2 points is where they must score from. And each player with a level of function that is denoted with the numerical value that effectively makes up their classification. And this for Roberts, And he takes it right across the line. So Robertson, his first Paralympic Games. And he, 29 years of age, he participates in those World Championships where Great Britain finishes fifth. And those were in Denmark. That was when that gold medal game for Canada. Where Biletsky, as you see, participates and becomes the first ever female to do that, as MADELL will take it across the line. So Roberts knew, but really the leading gun now for Great Britain. So much emphasized and on his shoulders. And he really carries it well. He puts it up here to Ayaz BHUTA. BHUTA will take this one across the line. So he's a very talented and nifty player. But he's not as big or as heavy. So when it gets into the physicality, into those parts of the game, he can be disrupted. WHITEHEAD takes the feet and he scores his opening goal. So a little bit of a different dynamic already you can see from the Canadians. As he's on the board, so a couple different scores, equally the same as you might expect from these opening lineups. So the higher pointed players with the higher level of function, and this is BHUTA with some good speed there, looking more assertive with that attack. So a total cumulative value of 8 on the floor at any one time. So a lowest level of function is a 0.5, all the way up to a 3.5. So these athletes will have impairments in both their lower limbs and their upper limbs. And you can just see, obviously, some of them are missing the lower part of their arm as well. They are really incredible how they are able to propel themselves with the wheelchairs as quick as they do. As every impairment and every story a little bit different, as it will be a timeout called by Canada. So this, as expected, is going to be tight. And with just coming up short by 2 goals against the Americans, did GB, or rather against the Australians, that's just what the margin will be. The question is coming in, because it is the Australians who are the reigning gold medal champions. They also sit atop in second position in the overall rankings. It's the United States that comes in at 1, Australia 2, Japan 3, Canada 4, and Great Britain 5. So that just shows you just how tight this match is expected to be. But it doesn't always run to form, what's on paper and equally what happens out here on the field of play. You need to be careful there that they don't give that ball back a little too early, because you've got to fully be in play. They've given it up here. That's the presence of the Canadian side, particularly WHITEHEAD, who is a bigger player, the biggest one out on the floor right now. MADELL, who will race with anybody, but he also likes to play physically. He bumps Roberts back there. He scores again. He really is like an Energizer bunny. He just does not stop. And not as many smiles on his face today. He was really enjoying it in day one against Brazil. It was alive and electric in this building, and it will build throughout the course of the day when the host nation participates at the end. So 4 games in the day's schedule. Turned over, GB do well here. Ayaz BHUTA has got support to get it, and then reaching right in is WHITEHEAD and says, I'll have that back, and he gets fouled, or he does commit the foul as he reaches in there. So just a little too much contact, the attempt. And you see him just looking across to the official. So that margin now could be leveled again. This pass over the top, and it's BHUTA who's awaiting to score. Leaves WHITEHEAD in that penalty box, and now he returns to the match. So that turnover, very indicating, as you can see, the scoreline now. We're even. A dozen points scored, and they're split right in half. And what happened on this play? It's going to be a technical timeout. It's a blown wheel. And in comes the Canadian bench just to saddle up. Just lock that into place. And that is number 10 for Canada, Trevor Hirschfield. So he and Patrice DAGENAIS share the duties. There are a number of players on this Canadian team that can equally carry that responsibility of leadership. You don't need a C necessarily in order to lead, to move forward and into a positive position here. A bumpy ride from Roberts as he comes in, and he wins a 50-50, so it's a possession arrow, and that works for Great Britain. And here, GB could take the lead They didn't get that opening tip-off, but here with this possession, this is a changing point in this matchup, and it just shows you, even in this early opening 3 minutes, you can tell that this is going to be tight all the way. A penalty now coming up to Canada, and you would expect with this possession, Great Britain to take the lead. So what would happen if there was a result here in full time for GB? Then it would be the matchup between the Canadians and the Australians. This really is kind of deemed or seen as the group of death, because there's three teams that really believe they should go to that semifinal round, and somebody's going to have to go, and they go into the classification. That's going to be heartbreaking, and that'll be determined early. So the offload into Walker. Walker with the safe hands and across the line. It is a Great Britain lead now, and they've done well just to hold court and not give up to some of this physical play coming in from MADELL. Whitehead isn't as assertive, but he is strong and just a real presence, as MADELL will take this one back. He's got a half dozen, and the other one belongs to Whitehead. So three different scores now, equally for Great Britain. That's a good omen. Just indicates that they've got their players engaged and involved in this one. But it's not unusual for Canada to rely so heavily upon MADELL. It's a scary notion that, though, isn't it, that so much of your offense comes from one player. If they were to suffer an injury. But these players made of very stern stuff. Right across, there's Robertson. He will score that one. That's the 8-1. So 4 points, 4 goals officially. Long pass, it's up, and awaiting at the other end is Hirschfield, the 32-year-old. And he will score. So his father, Bobby, is the actual equipment manager for the Canadian National Wheelchair Rugby team. So it's a family affair. What a great experience to enjoy these moments together and have your father equally on the bench as part of the official setup of the side. Reaching in, that is Chan. And is he going to get a penalty for it? He is. He's going off. And he's been a part of this program since Sydney, all the way through. So his fifth Paralympic Games. Also part of that famous documentary, Murder Ball, that was tracking both Canada and USA in their heated rivalry along that 49th parallel ahead of the 2004 Athens Games. And that has inspired a boatload of these athletes, the way they have looked at that, seen that story, and thought, I want to do the same, be a part of it. But now this is GB, who have just got their nose in front, alternating back and forth with Canada, and Canada do their best to level, and if they can turn it over, they've done it, picked it up, and a little bit of driving right past this one. We've seen that a couple times, and this now, very impressively, a 2-point lead for GB. And MADELL couldn't get that one. His speed was so much that he just ran over the ball. And again, Canada with the heat of the action. And BHUTA gets rammed from behind. Canada are just losing the edge a little bit so far. And the play from MADELL trying to make enough. He just lodges it, does so well. Is that going to get out, though? Who last touches it? And GB will keep it. This game right now. And the Canadians, in both of the matches they have played, they play a high-octane brand of wheelchair rugby. It's speed, it's assertion, and right here, it's a little bit of a wheelchair rugby ball hurdle that MADELL would have loved that to have maybe stopped him in his tracks. So maybe could have got it. At least it would have gone to a review. It is picked up easily as the Canadians are awaiting a couple substitutions. Chan, they're now assembled, and they'll utilize this as a timeout, as Byletsky is right there as well. She'll be back into the game. And this is the most that you can feel that the Canadians have been realistically tested in the 5 periods that they have played. This one obviously not done yet, but they were tested in their opener against Brazil. There's no doubting of it, but it just felt as though the result in the end was likely to be Canada's. Brazil ranked number 19 officially in the world. So, but again, it's that's the host nation with a home crowd behind them. Anything could have happened in that one, but it was a comfortable victory in the end by 14 goals. It's deliberate. And with inside a single digits now, Roberts is going to make a pass over the back, and it's across the line with both wheels and a little spin out as well from Walker. So he's got three goals. Good balance so far. We're seeing from Great Britain as they go three ahead, and Canada need to respond because you just cannot allow these turnovers, and surprisingly, they've done it again. Roberts will take that one away. He's got a Land Rover with 4x4 action on it as he just rototills his way across the line one more time. And this a little bit surprising right now. Canada are getting worked over as it will be a second bounce in the MADELL. And they've just been a little bit loose, turning this ball and giving it to GB on these inbounds. And you have to be calculating and very efficient. They move it in. It's COGGAN into Walker. Much better ball movement today from GB. It's back now to Walker. He's got BHUTA. They're advancing it too quickly, and MADELL, no matter how fast he is, he can't move as quick as that ball. HIRSCHFIELD will come in, and he adds some defensive support. Offloaded, good accurate passing. DB is on the money as it's tic-tac-toe, and another goal is scored. And it looks as though Walker needs some support. His wheel, he is sharp. He's in second position behind Roberts in overall output offensively right now for this GB side. So they got the memo, didn't they, Great Britain, that game number two was going to really set the table one way or the other for how this tournament was going to shape out. And they have started on time, and they have put a lot of pressure on Canada, but now it's double digits. And they don't need to panic from here, but they just can't give up the ball as they have done already in this opening quarter. So the American and the Aussie in charge of this one. Roberts, he is really, he's got speed to burn. He's going to take BILETSKI to the line here one more time. Meningitis at 19 for Roberts at his first year of university that led to having to have both of his legs amputated below the knee. What a player he is for GB now. He was named the best 3.0 class player at the 2015 European Championships. Those were in Finland. WHITEHEAD now powering forward, and they do need just another option. It's too much right now, the Zak Male show. And that'll dry up. To say that MADELL is really being threatened to be closed down by anybody, but it's a team approach right now from GB that's more potent. Ayaz performing better in day two as well in the second matchup for GB. Long pass into WHITEHEAD. He's gonna have to spin, he gets away, but he's got two of them. He's gonna ram himself into Roberts. The offload up. Rather, that was the good work there from MADELL originally. And this into WHITEHEAD. He has to bounce it or pass it every 10 seconds in order to keep the possession alive. He has gone the long way around. They have 40 seconds in total on the shot clock available to them. Gavin now studying this one closely. And is this going to be a foul or is this going to be 50-50? It is. That's the back official assessing it as a 50-50, and it's worked out well this time for Canada. So that's the risk you take. And I'm just mentally thinking about the amount of times I've seen that challenge, and about 20% of the time you are successful with a 50-50, maybe as much as 30. The other third, you pick up a penalty, and maybe the other third of the times you're able to knock it out of their hands. So it really is a risk, but it's a calculated one. And for Canada, they need to score to bring us back within two. And of course, they'd love to disrupt it again inside this last minute of the opening period. Get it within one, but this is MADELL. He will just wait and make sure he's clean across the line. So he's left 12.2 seconds beyond that 40-second possibility for GB if they do convert, so they can get the last goal. But within two, they're going to try and get him to turn it over. They're in a full four-court press. Knocked it down. MADELL has done well. He'll come all the way back if he has to. He's right up against Roberts. These two are basically the mirror of each other. MADELL protects it, bounces it to himself. He's got Whitehead up forward, Biletsky and Hirschfield doing some cross-blocking. And now it's about clock management. I think MADELL knows that he's got the sights set for that line. They've been able to wrap up Roberts because Roberts is tiring out their top scorer for Canada. So that's the job that the other athlete's doing. Good work there. They've done it again twice. Hirschfield and Biletsky take out Roberts. And inside this last 10 seconds, they're trying to just wait and manage his clock down. So there he does, take it across the line. It's within one. It's exactly what Canada wanted. They assert themselves in the last 90 seconds, perhaps. Roberts is not going to give it a turnover. He's going to hold on to it, and he gives it back to the referee. So it's got a little closer at the end. They were ahead by as much as three. I think they were up as far as four at a point. Was GB, but the opening 8 minutes, Great Britain just with their nose ahead, 15-14 over Canada. This will be a thriller from beginning to end, and it'll set up who is most likely to be going through in one of those semi-final positions. The defensive fouls from Canada, three of them committed. They've turned it over five times. That's uncharacteristic. And then you equally see the steals in favor, reflecting there for Great Britain. And then the penalties as well. And the reflection of the defensive fouls. So Canada, probably a little bit, maybe surprised to be trailing right now. But GB were dynamic. They had good balance, and they distributed the scoring through their top players. Gavin Walker, Jim Roberts, and Ayaz BHUTA getting them off the mark. Underway now in the second quarter of 8 minutes, four of them obviously making up the 32 in full play. We would, if there was a tie at the end, we would keep going into 3 minute scoring or into the extra play, but we haven't required that as yet. There have been close matches, but this for Roberts into the scoring area. They cannot occupy that more than 10 seconds, the offensive players. And are they gonna give a foul here against the Canadians? It looks as though. Just see the official scoring. So he reaches in. And it is a defensive foul. It's Caldwell who gets called for it. So that comes in prior to the contact there, then the opening score right now. Roberts is just awaiting to take it across. He does. So that was four against three. Caldwell, the 28-year-old. So MADELL doing most of the driving here. There's a good little cross block coming in from Caldwell. Just opens things up, but it's hard work for MADELL. And that's the problem when you are relying so heavily on one player. He you don't want to become a one-trick pony in this particular sport. You need the balance across your lineup. And MADELL has found some room on this backside. So this, a different assembled lineup from Kevin Orr in this second period. And the babyface assassin who came into the Paralympic level in London as an 18-year-old, Zak Male, now 22, from Alberta. Tried his hand at the other Paralympic sports as well, but found this obviously most to his liking. And when you're one of the best in the world, that of course is always a little bit more enjoyable. And he's been dominant ever since he's been a part of it. But this now, Roberts, he's in his first Paralympic Games. He equally has been dominant for Great Britain. He really is the number one. And BHUTA here with the ball elects to call the timeout. Aaron Phipps, a big part of this program. They had to fill that gap as he no longer is playing Paralympic sport. He retired. So this, as it's gone back and forth in these opening couple of minutes, GB just want to make sure that they have their plan together. They're in a great position with their nose in front right now. Walker being counted in, so you see the referee's arm there. They have 10 seconds in which to advance it, so he was about halfway through that allocation. BHUTA, they're just trying to put an anchor on him, make life difficult. MADELL is having to match up, really doing the work of a couple of players here. And a timeout called again by GB. So they have the 30-second variety and also the 60 seconds. This is a swing point in the game. You do get a sense that if Canada were able to take and measure this up and get a level and then take the lead, that they might not look back. And GB, they know that, and they're playing well enough to maintain that one-point lead. But this is going to get hot and heated. And the Canadian lineup is going to need part of that supporting cast to really come forward. So MADELL just keeping things together as he rallies his team, make sure that they understand their responsibility. They've got Simard out there. Cody Caldwell is also in action, but Great Britain, this really is their tournament. They have to in this matchup. They need a victory. They even more than Canada. And then the Canadians could go against Australia, but I got a feeling it's going to come down to tiebreakers between these three nations, the way it is going so far. But we shall see how it plays. It's in, and COGGAN's getting bumped around. He's been knocked out, and COGGAN's got that long bumper on. He's more of a defensive player. He's a lower classification. See him chatting about it. You see the protection he has on the outside of his hands as well there. That's just a little bit of extra support, making sure that if the wheels do contact him, that he's just supporting his fingers from getting crunched. There, MADELL, he puts himself into a high traffic area. He protects the ball. He's got another player. If he can get out of here, he's in good shape. He's called a timeout. You could see that GB had tracked him. They had the sonar arm, and they had him right up against that sideline. And you see him just trying to shrug it off, but this is becoming a real tactical battle right now between these two nations. The restart. Canada in black with the red wheels. GB in white. They've got the black frames, the big wheels, the covering on their spokes. These are like little tanks, these wheelchairs. So heavy in their construction. That is a dangerous play, but they execute it. So well taken by Caldwell. They go to the left-handed delivery over the top, and he takes that. That's his first goal perfectly on the money. He has to catch that before his wheels start to engage that scoring line. And Canada right now are going to try to break this play up. And if they can, of course, going back and try to take the lead, they have not had it in this matchup. But dead level at 16. And Roberts has gone a couple different routes. Can he come to the near side? He's being watched just as closely by Simard with that big chair. And who leaves? Is it MADELL? I think MADELL leaves. And are they going to say penalty box for him? Or are they going to award the point? And so he's on his way to the penalty box. So what they suggest that is that the defensive player is trying to disrupt the attack. And he comes across now there to the penalty box. So for a minute or less, he's in there. It'll be less than that as they have 40 seconds on the scoring clock. And the inbound for GB. They'll try to keep MADELL off the field of play for as long as possible. Just manage this second quarter. So this is where the chess element comes in. Roberts, he elects to score. Doesn't utilize the full allocation available to him. Over was GB trying to get in the way of MADELL, but he'll make the inbound. Where's his target, though? He makes a strong pass up. It's well taken. BHUTA with Walker. Try to make Caldwell make a mistake, and he's called the timeout. So you're seeing just how effective the execution of a game plan is for Great Britain, or trying to keep calm. But these are tense moments. Only in just simple play of inbounding, you're seeing all manner of discussion and timeouts, because this is where the game is going to be won and lost. So the timekeeper's bench just needing clarity and the referee to come across. So the play will be restarted. Looks like things are under control. There's the thumbs up. So Caldwell goes into MADELL. And this maintaining of the lead is a big mental thing equally as well for Great Britain. They've not trailed. Yes, it's been level, but they've been able to come back as MADELL records a 17th point. And you do just feel that it is going to come down to just a moment or two, maybe a couple minutes in one of these periods where you fall asleep, you just don't execute. Almost Walker, that's a great play to come up with it. They've done well to get BHUTA though, and track the back. Caldwell one-on-one defensively here, doing his best. And are they suggesting there's a penalty there? They almost had BHUTA up and out of his chair, but he will score this one. And it's into MADELL, so each one of these possessions is key. The big hit coming from Roberts. Simard will protect that one down, 37 years of age. And where will the next advancement come from? MADELL is putting a block out there on BHUTA, but you need to come back and help your personnel. He does. He swings around the end. And he's just run out of real estate on the backside. Inside is the pass to Simard, and there now a little bit more distribution in the scoring. The whistle from the referee. They've put the 18 on the board, but let's just watch it here again. The feed internally. He was in good shape, and then BHUTA just knocks it out of his hand there at the end, and the referee was just suggesting to Ayaz, no need for that. We've got this game under control. We will reinsert the ball. Walker, he's having a great game. As he just takes this forward, he shows some tremendous speed. And Walker is a 2.0, so to get that type of output, he got 7 goals in the opener. He's on 5 right now, still more to go, so he is ahead of his pace as to what he contributed to the overall score against the Australians. And that bodes well. That's why Great Britain are in the position they are currently, is that secondary output. BHUTA in that one, he got 7, and he's on 4, so they're ahead of schedule. Just ever so slightly right now. And double threes, there he is, MADELL has called the timeout. That was just to maintain possession and a chance to try and level this at 19. And the interesting thing is you look at Madell, he's probably young enough that he doesn't think about the pressure that he's under here. But he really is the guy that holds this all together for Canada. Whitehead, the other player that when they run as a 1-2 punch, and when Whitehead is on, they really can be outstanding. But Kevin Orr electing to assemble this pack of four right now. Caldwell has been that number two to him. He's been sensible. He's also just been smart defensively, working hard. He's got a goal, but there's 14 goals so far of the 19 coming from Madell. One from Caldwell, Hirschfield the co-captain, Simard with another one, and two from Whitehead. But Whitehead is waiting to return to action. Caldwell can't quite get to BHUTA here, and Ayaz is having a great game so far. So he with five. Caldwell is indicating where he wants Madell to open up to, and Madell has got enough space there and equally distance from the two tracking British players. He'll go right across the line. This is where Canada are looking to try and dispossess GB. They've been so smart, and with the ball management so far of BHUTA and equally Walker, you count on Roberts, but it's a better showing right now. This is giving, that's a great move, so clever. Just dipping around the defense. And BHUTA with good energy, speed, and body control. Just keeps giving Great Britain that nose ahead. But as the saying goes, you only need to be in the lead once. And that's coming the end of 32 minutes when the horn sounds. There's so much more to be played. You see the discussion between Roberts and Madell. They really are the 1-2 punch. Or basically the top for each of their respective sides. And the scoring, Madell with 15, Roberts with 9. But you lose track with that because there's so much more than just the scoring that is being factored into a good performance. As that'll be taken by the Canadians. And it's Simard now with a second goal. He's doing his job. And that's the great thing about wheelchair rugby. It's a level playing field for these athletes with these different classifications. And obviously different stories to get to this particular platform, the peak of Paralympic sport here in Rio. But it's a timeout, the opportunity at 21s apiece for both sides to reflect and whether the Canadians can employ a different strategy to try to steal the ball here. This is Roberts, the cross field play, much better. Whitehead is out there, he's a heavy body. He just takes up a little bit more space, and also he's got a reach to maybe try and dislodge that ball if it's in your lap. Madell waiting for Roberts. They're gonna try to come here over on Bilitsky's side. But Whitehead, he'll control a good chunk of that 4 meters. They've turned it over. This is what they were waiting for. A race for glory, and Canada will pluck this one. It's a cherry off the cherry tree. And that, a moment that they had really needed for the last 8 minutes or so at the end of that first quarter, and that's what Whitehead will give you. He's a big maple leaf tree, and he knocks and shakes off a little acorn for the Canadians there. So is that telling? As we come to the end of this first half of play, Bilitsky with that long chair Oh, they've opened it up for Roberts, almost a beneficiary of the over movement from the Canadian defenders. He just spun around. But this, every time now, it's Canada's turn to try and just nudge ahead. And GB have been good. Walker and Roberts are all over Whitehead. The offload, the ball movement is king. Position is also king. And can you execute passes right into Whitehead? And that is as easy as they will come. It just drops right into the breadbasket. And he puts it across the line. So inside this last minute, the Canadians will be just happy if they can make Great Britain work for it. They don't want to make a mistake. And they would love to be able to finish this half with their nose in front. They've worked so hard from being behind throughout the majority of this opening 16 minutes. Now BHUTA, he wants to manage the clock. They've got 16 seconds exactly. So there's an 8-second disparity between the shot clock. And what they'll probably try and do is bring it right down, and maybe they'll call a timeout, but they have utilized the bunch and they're gonna get across the line. So that's a score at 13.8 is enough time for Canada to respond, but it's a great controlled play to be able to find an answer. And MADELL, the offload, he will just weave and wind. Roberts is gonna force him back, and Roberts actually leaves the field of play. It's going to be an inbound as being assessed here. Will be a penalty. We'll just see how the officials want to call this one. Sometimes they'll just award that as an automatic. But it's going to be a defensive foul against Roberts. So it goes to 4-on-3. And the substitution coming in. And this last 6.9, it almost feels like the end of the match. It's in for Whitehead. MADELL is gonna cross block. Whitehead is a big logger. He takes it across one more time. He's, well, he owns the road if you're gonna be on it. Once he gets rolling, he's gonna be tough to stop. And Canada have just got to a 2-4 pack of points by the end of the opening 16 minutes. And it was tight against the Australians, Great Britain. And it's equally as tight as bark to a tree in this one, as Canada will take the lead at halftime over Great Britain, 24-23 in the wheelchair rugby. This is Group A action. So the defensive fouls, the Canadians the culprits, committing 6 of those, turnovers each side, more steals from Great Britain. They really have been excellent in managing the ball, the Canadians having to take a few more penalties, and the pressure on. This feels very much like a medal match in this early round, and that is quite the outfit you're seeing there from the Canadian faithful. It's obviously somebody's birthday, as they, with the big smiling faces of their Canadian players in full support. It's a break for halftime. These teams will just keep themselves warm and ticking over, bubbling ready for what will equally, I expect this will go right down the wire with the remaining 16 minutes left. second half in this Group A preliminary match. It feels like a medal game, and it really is, between number 4 and 5 in the world, vying to put themselves into a definite position. For Canada, it would certainly give them that of a top two position in the group. For Great Britain, it would keep them alive with a chance with one remaining game to go. And that really is the battle that is going on here. So Canada get the opening score. They had the opening tip, and then the start of the second period went to Great Britain. And now they are ahead by 2 points. So they'll need to be smart, as Roberts quickly will score right back again to just cut it to 1. And his overall scoring today, under the direction of that man, Paul Shaw, Roberts is on 12, 17 for MADELL. And this now up, it's HIRSCHFIELD who takes this into control, and he'll score for the Canadians. So the joint captain of the side now with a couple of goals for Canada. A 1.0 classification, and that is a big hit coming in from MADELL as he upends Roberts, and Roberts down on the floor just giving instructions to his teammates, and rather a prone position there. Here he comes, the cross, and as soon as you catch the player from that side position like that, particularly, I'm not sure Roberts was anticipating the force from MADELL. And he tries to break his fall. But it's all part of it. You accept it, but no player likes that. And it brings about just the opportunity here for the reinsert from the sideline. But a lot of players, well, they enjoy that side of it. Everybody wants to be the hitter, not the hittee. And in that instance, it was Roberts who sets the offensive table for Great Britain once again. They got MADELL and Whitehead out there. That has proven to be probably their strongest combination. Almost there. HIRSCHFIELD goes in like a serpent's tongue, tries to just lash that out of his possession. And he recovers it just as quickly, doesn't he, Roberts? Into the hands of MADELL. MADELL, these two just give as best they can to this match. They are the respective leaders. And now that's 18 for the Canadian. And what award hasn't he been winning? Individual accolades aplenty for Zak MADELL in his young career. He probably, in many ways, is following in the footsteps of what has been forged by Riley Batt, the Australian, who's highly regarded as the best player in this sport. It comes down to on the day, and equally, there are a handful of teams that can all be vying for a gold medal. It's that secondary support that really will determine which teams are going to go the deepest. Roberts, he has his sat nav locked in. He put the postcode of the Canadian goal line in it, and that really was short work. He took the quickest route, maybe not the most direct, and often the quickest route for him is just for him to put it in his lap and get rolling. Whitehead over the top. This could be tough. Try to get under MADELL. MADELL comes up with it. He's just kept timeout. No, he hasn't been able to. He offloads it. Can he win it back as a 50-50? And you're wondering whether MADELL was trying to call a timeout just ahead of it, but he threw it back like the hot potato because he knew he'd already gone across the line. And I wonder whether or not he was just out, but it's irrelevant, really, as he goes back in again and he tries to wrestle for that one. And he into the penalty box area commits another foul. So with 4 against 3 play, Great Britain expected to level this here. So this is a real swing because Canada had been ahead by as much as 2. And from here, it is back to level of 28. And you would bet big odds that GB are going to score here. The only fluctuation I have seen is a team that is shorthanded. They have scored while they've had 3 players out as opposed to 4, but I have never seen the team that has a 4-against-3 advantage not convert with that player advantage. So it's pretty much as certain as taxes. As here comes another inbound for Canada. Need to be, you see that offloading coming so quick, it's always assumed that the player who's inbounded, who doesn't get a good push on his first effort to get in play, well, he receives that ball when he's still out of bounds. And this has been forced again. And Canada have just run out of a little bit of gas here. So just confirm, it's a defensive foul for MADELL, but he's back out there. And they've just given it back. And this little exchange, as we've seen, rings about a call for a timeout from Orr, as they've had a two-point lead evaporate, and now a chance here for Great Britain to reassert it. Caldwell having a good game. He is in this lineup right now. And there is his fan club, 28 years of age. He's been a steady number for the Maple Leafs in this one. Very active defensively, putting a lot of pressure on. MADELL up against Roberts. They just throw on the brakes. This is across the line. And 4-on-4, you expect GB to retake the lead, and they've done that. And again, another shift in the story, as Great Britain back in front by just the one. Big hit there, reaching in. And now some new players, Chris Ryan, the captain for Great Britain, on the floor. And this a little bit more balance from Canada, as Simard will score. That's his third. So now the pressure on GB with each of these successive possessions to convert. The passing play is a great one. It's passed up to Roberts. That is important, that linking play. It's one thing to rely on one player to do it, but you have to have the passing game. Caldwell is gonna have to go a long ways here. Is he gonna run out of time? He needs to be careful. It's into MADELL. That's a great pass, because MADELL has Roberts right on him. And the contact on the arm will lead to a penalty, but that's a risky play because Caldwell spins out and fires that one across, and MADELL has the player right against them. And it was Roberts, whose hands are as capable as any on the floor right now. So waiting to battle up in front of him. The cross block reaching in. The Canadians are just trying to disrupt this possession. He will have to give it up. This now is going into Jamie Stead. And the feed in, it's a great one into Ryan, just the handoff. Almost like the baton. And that's a really smart move. Make it easy and simple. Don't try to complicate things. Don't need to be flashy, just good fundamental rugby. And make certain of possession and control. They're gonna have to let MADELL just score that one. So you're getting that same feeling again as we saw at the end of the opening half, that this is gonna come down to one mistake potentially. All the way, the length of the floor, Jimmy Stead will score. So he puts it on the board, and it's a 32 for GB. And there the distribution of scoring, very similar so far, but there's just been a little bit more from the secondary personnel. That's a dangerous play. It's been turned over again. We've seen it. And has it been touched? It's contact on the arm by Caldwell. He might have been just as happy in that instance to have taken an over and back, but the violation, either way, it has not gone well for Canada. And you're starting to see a little, a few chinks in their composure at the right times. A couple plays that have probably been forced that have led now to Great Britain advancing it up. Jamie Stead takes the play from Chris Ryan. And four against three. Unless they strip it from Great Britain, you're expecting another GB score. The offload to Ryan. And he's the captain for a reason. He's cerebral and he's controlled. He takes it across and sets it down for the official. So where does this match go from here? Seeing Orr chatting with his bench staff. I think you can also see that the expressions there, they know that the tension is mounting and they put themselves in a very precarious position by not taking care of business against Great Britain. Great Britain know that they have to win too. So for different reasons, both of these teams desperate. Just back on the floor, that is so tight, that feed, and it really depends on Caldwell being assertive enough. He gets across in 12 seconds, but he's in a tight jam. That passing hasn't been flawless from the Canadians. Almost stripped, he does so well to protect that before he backs away on that line, that center line, to get it to MADELL. MADELL will find a way to score from here. You expect it, but Roberts cuts him off at that pass. He'll have to go around the mountain to the other side. Inside to Simard, and he will convert it. It's a good offload. And he's being counted on heavily, is Simard right now. Have not seen Whitehead in a while. Just interesting distribution of the playing time from Kevin Orr. This will be a reflection of how, if they were to get to a medal match, how they would distribute the floor time. Obviously, all depending on health of your personnel. But this has been good work coming on for GB between Stead and Ryan, working with Roberts, and then COGGAN out there as well. Just had a little bit more balance about their play, and they've managed it. They've been smart. Again, Stead comes around. He's controlled on the backside. HIRSCHFIELD tries to get to him. Simard just does a little bit of a moonwalk into that position. Stead trying to get around the end. A good block from Ryan opens it up again, and there's that two-point margin. That is really outstanding work. Patient and showing the poise in those pressure moments. That's a great omen for TV. Inside the last couple minutes now of this third period, they turn it over again from behind Stead. And the ball management right now from Canada, it's a little bit leaky. And these are tough to overcome. As Roberts tries to take the air out of the balloon a little bit, when the game is emotional and on edge, that's when MADELL really has his engine revving, and that's when he's most dangerous. They're trying here. They just reach into his bread basket. And it's almost like he's heading down the road on his bike and somebody's just put a spoke or a stick right in his spokes and just upended him. He really feels certain, doesn't he, MADELL, that when he has that ball that he's gonna take it and deliver the mail for this side. Not to be on that play. And Orr, a little bit of a wince as he looks up at the scoreboard here. It's a 12-8 scoreline right now for Great Britain in this third period. And the steals 2-1, and the pressure coming. Caldwell's getting counted, he's got to advance it up. MADELL immediately into some traffic, but he advances it well, taken by Simard. And this is feeding like GB are turning the screw. They might just have the right tool as well. They're putting in the square head to turn the screw and tighten it. And the Canadians, they just might be coming apart just ever so slightly. That's the question. 2 points is not much, but it's a possession game. And that means it's two possessions that they have to stop and win back. And the inbound coming up in this fourth period of play will be for GB, but can they disrupt at the last second here? They will not. Ryan, with some calm control at the line, converts that one. So remember, the inbound of the first possession of the fourth period belongs to Great Britain. And they already have a three-point lead, and the pressure now on Canada to try and score. The advancement up to Madell. He will not handle it cleanly. He's given it up, and this again is starting to show the pressure mounting. Stead and Ryan with Roberts have really been outstanding coming on. They have a four-point advantage in this quarter alone. And upended, they need some support to get the Canadian player upright. So with 14.2, they could very much just take this Great Britain and manage the remainder and go up by four and also have the inbound. That's a lot of pressure now on Canada. Roberts with control. Whitehead, another big body. They can use him out there. Can he stop things? They may have. They've just broken it up, and that's important there. And you've seen Whitehead utilized in those goal line stances a couple times in this match. They had a steal earlier, and I expect he will be utilized for the remaining eight. They're going to need a big push now, our Canada. The inbound coming again from Great Britain to start the fourth quarter, but after three periods of play, GB 36, Canada 33, and this is going to go down to the wire. It's the turnovers, Canada 2-1 committing them, and the steals more than 2-1, the advantage for Great Britain. That is the difference in this score right now. The defensive fouls equally leading to all of those odd man advantage or player advantages for GB that they have been converting to. So too many openings being presented right now by the Canadians to Great Britain, and they're taking advantage of each and every single one of them. It's in, and Roberts safely with control starts this fourth period. And Biletsky is out there as well. Whitehead, Hirschfield, and Madell. It's COGGAN, Ryan, Stead, and Roberts to start this one for GB. Have they pushed him out? And they have done that, so it's a turnover. And that's a smart play by Madell. They needed that. You expected GB to go up by four. And it's now the inbound for Canada. So all of the mistakes that Canada have made in this one, it's Whitehead, who was a big target, offloading to Madell. He will drive forward, and he's gone. He's got away from Roberts early at that halfway point. It's cut to two. And right there, within 30 seconds, he's suggesting to stay back. He will start to put the pressure on. That's what Madell is instructing to his teammates. I will apply pressure in the right places at the right time here on this GB side and try to get turnovers. He's doing exactly that. He's created enough congestion. The offload, can Whitehead get to it? It's up to Roberts, great play. And that's just the smarts as they try to get into Roberts. The hitting, the cross block there, advancing it up, and well played by Great Britain. They use the push and pull at the right time. Whitehead was maybe going to pass it long, but they know how to stay with Madell. He's got to come underneath. And the offload over to the big Canadian. And he'll score. Been a while since he's put one on the board, but that's his fifth in the match. They need him to be going. He's going to give the Canadians the best chance to be able to break this down right now with Madell. Just as Stead and Ryan have, with Roberts coming out. They've jammed things up. The pressure coming from Whitehead, and they will distribute it and wait again. See how they can reformulate this approach. Both sides, they come around. Stead with a good decoy there, and he does just nestle inside this left post. Hirschfield to Whitehead. Madell reaching back. He's just gonna power his way. He's gonna hold it, protect it across the line. And even overemphasizing that just for to make a point that he was in certain control. So this, a seesaw battle. It's another dispossession they're looking for. They're looking to try to steal this ball. They've done it, Whitehead. They force it back here, and is this gonna lead now to an over and back? They've just overgone the play, and that was a little careless from Great Britain. Instead, I'm not sure whether he just couldn't go down, the 22-year-old, and get that one. He ends up just rolling past it and leaves it right there. It's back within one, and here comes the press. Madell. They try to squeeze him off, but he's just too quick, isn't he, Roberts? Into that space. So this is swinging in the balance right now. Advancing out to Madell. Nobody's gonna track him. It's a good angled pass right through the middle of the floor. But it's right here that the Canadians need again to try and break it up. The inbound most likely to go into Roberts, as we've seen. He's got it now, so they're gonna retreat and just have the one player. They're gonna try to hold, break it up, use the height, the presence, and the physicality of Whitehead maybe in this scoring area just to congest things. They force Roberts the other side. He's met his match in the inside, and that is Madell already leaving the field of play. They're gonna count that as a score. So we're just seeing whether or not they're going to count that turnover out of bounds. So that was deemed Great Britain went out. I thought Madell had. So you see the inbound there. And what a moment here where Canada, after falling down by as much, and is this a possession arrow that's going to work out for GB? It is in favor of Canada. You can see it there on the bench. So protecting it well. As soon as the inbound comes, obviously the arrow will direct the opposite way in favor of Great Britain. So officially the term is a held ball for Whitehead, and they don't convert. And it's just too far. He leaves and doesn't, it's just too forceful a pass. And they have really left it on the table there, have Canada. Those moments could come back to haunt them. And obviously there's been an accumulation of a number of them in the first half, but you come at the second half to really put pressure on these moments in time where you have to execute. Roberts gets upended. And did he call timeout before he's fallen? And they're suggesting a contact on the arm. What will be the call? Let's just see officially. And as you see coming across, Roberts is down. It was turned over by Whitehead. And as we've got our stat tracker here, and you see the advancement, it's the big hit. And he lets the 22-year-old go down. It was time out, called by Great Britain just in time. But we'll see, this is time out because they need the support to get back upright. And you see the fall instead. So Roberts, right on it, the referees. immediate call was to reach to the arm, like there was contact on the arm. So it is a turnover. The official action is called a physical advantage. We'll watch it again. Coming in, Stead goes down. The play into Roberts. Two British players upended on that play. And Biletsky doing her job to occupy the right space at the right time. They had a chance to level last time. If they were able to have converted it, they could have taken the lead in this one. But this is to just get it to 39s apiece. MADELL takes control. He's trying to get away from that pressure. He bounces it, releases it inside, and it will be HIRSCHFIELD to score for Canada. And this is entirely in the balance right now as HIRSCHFIELD gets himself three goals. And this is, as I've said a number of times, effectively a medal match right now. Who gets the 40 first? You expect it to be Great Britain with Roberts now. It's 4-on-4, up against Whitehead. He'll get through him, and he has enough momentum and the angle to get across that line. So that takes him to an even 20. Paul Shaw looking on anxiously. He really has been quite calm, in fairness, on that GB bench. And he's talking about how difficult it was to watch at that home Paralympics. GB finished fifth. Is that another battle that they might face in this one here? They're both now on 40. And that really is what's likely to take place here. If Canada does not win this one, well, then they go to a position where they're reliant on a scoreline between Australia and this group against Brazil as well. So you just lose control of the control you have in this group if you don't win your games, and that's obvious. But Whitehead will receive this one. And from where will this next score come? It's MADELL over to Whitehead. He's got double coverage. It almost seems like they've got an extra player out there. That's because wide open is HIRSCHFIELD to take a score. And now both sides equally at 41. So without the extra game in this tournament, with only eight teams, you can use just the flow of being at this top level in order to make sure you're sharp and in tune. And both of these teams in the second day of the competition right now cannot make a mistake. Up against BHUTA. BHUTA is going to just again slide into that little crevice and across the line. His size, his advantage there. Reaching in for MADELL. MADELL just carves his way through. Quick advancement. And that's where you're seeing all the pressure on MADELL, where he looks struggling or he's challenged to get through. It's because HIRSCHFIELD's wide open. So they're getting the double coverage on MADELL initially. And then he's advancing it up to Whitehead in back-to-back plays. Then they've linked it all the way forward up to HIRSCHFIELD. But can they turn it over here? BHUTA has had some good speed here. Roberts with a cross block, trying to hand it off. So much work. Oh, Roberts does well to get into the opening behind. But Canada recover into space. The offload, they've moved it so well here. The big man, Whitehead. MADELL inside, back to BHUTA. BHUTA with a great receive from Roberts. And they are earning their position right now with just the nudge ahead. At seven now for BHUTA. Whitehead was going to go long and strong. He's done a double dip there with two 360s, full 720. And here comes MADELL. He's always got the option around the end. He knows he can do it himself, so he will score it. So this really is getting very tense. And they really both deserve the opportunity to compete for a medal in Rio. But crushingly, one of them is going to have their story with a little bit of a twist to it right now. doesn't mean the tournament is over. It just means as we go and we look at the bracket and start doing the math about the total points scored in the games that they've played each other, it's just, it's still out there. You know, Great Britain will take the lead again. Kevin Orr shows you exactly what everybody for the Canadians is feeling. That was a dangerous play. I don't even think Hirschfield knew it was coming. Could have easily gone off the back of him. Throw on the brakes one more time, and he's almost like he's sliding on the road, so the snow falling, the ice is on it, and he's skidding, but he finds a way to right the ship and gets that Canadian car back on track, puts the chains on the wheels just to make sure he can get where he needs to go. At 44 and under a buck and a half still to go in this one, where will it travel now? BHUTA. He's got Roberts. It's a little too easy. And he's going to hold to come back. So patience. You can hear a pin drop in here. It's turned into a library all of a sudden. Just the tension. As we wait to see just how this will play out. We're inside of the last minute. And from here, Canada cannot make a mistake. They have to convert to force this one. MADELL, again, he's got a triple team going there. The cross block is good. He will try to take it across and score as quickly as he can. And that'll give at least a disparity if Great Britain tries to utilize all of the 40 seconds. So now they've got a decision to make. Do they want to? In this possession, it could all change. They've got through. It's only back. It's MADELL, BILETSKI there in the back flanks. WHITEHEAD's going to go around, and this is going to be ball management 101. They're going to try to just reduce this score, and then Canada has to be perfect. If they could just keep counting this down. So they have 10 seconds officially on the clock. Have they turned it over? Hirschfield got a touch on it. It's back for Roberts, inside now. And Ryan, MADELL's going to try and hunt him down, turning it over to BHUTA. BHUTA will get upended. He'll get thumped at the last second, and MADELL will dump him. And this, with 9.2 seconds, could just be the twist that the Canadians have been waiting for. That is what this game is all about. It's the physicality. You watch it again. BHUTA, who hasn't got the body weight of some of the other players on the floor, he looked as though he had the movement across this line. Ryan gets upended by MADELL, and then BHUTA also does. It's a double crush from the Canadian, as he just may have got two for the price of one on that play. What a moment, as now the inbound, 9.2. They'll go into WHITEHEAD, he's got it. MADELL is trying to get loose. WHITEHEAD can go long. This could be drama, it's gonna be drama. Can they get it loose though? They can't, as the time is gonna run out all the way the length of the floor, and we will stay at 45s right to the end of the 32 minutes here now. And this is drama indeed, as it will in fact push on now. And the Canadians thought they had their window right at the end. And how do you like them now? As the fourth period plays out and we level up at 45. There was that 3-point advantage for Great Britain going into it. Both teams with their opportunities to take this result already. And now we will carry on and keep pushing, as this is the entire match so far. Turnovers, the Canadians, that started to measure out. The defensive fouls, they're still the greater culprits. But the steals still in the advantage for GBR. Where will it go now? As we need to have a result in such a small group in tournament to determine. And we talk about this being a medal match. Well, it's not gonna be any more dramatic than this. So the drama continues as we go now to overtime number one. And these two sides, it's a Commonwealth Classic as the mother country, Great Britain, against the Canadians. And it looked at a spell like Great Britain was going to teach the Canadians a lesson, but it went into the latter stages and now the 3-minute overtime periods. So Canada already with an opening score. And where will we go from here? Roberts, now number 9, drops the needle. He'll get moving, quickly advanced up to BHUTA. BHUTA, who got worked there at the line, he'll score this opening try and goal for Great Britain. And he just got popped by MADELL. That really was an outstanding play. And as we look back, as far as one moment of getting it done, Zak MADELL really lowered the boom for the Canadians. Double trouble, and he was both the doubles. As all the way long this will go, Roberts, who's been upended by BILETSKI, and you'll see just what that front bumper will do. It'll get under and, of course, as we've seen, upend the players, but HIRSCHFIELD wraps around that one. And so just awaiting now, everybody rolling and ready. Well, my. It's good as it gets. And when I say a medal match, it really is, in a sense, the way it's being played and what's on the line here. Coming around is BHUTA for a second wave of this attack. The only one back is BILETSKI. And WHITEHEAD will just concede. You'll let him get this one. So equally again, a couple points apiece in this first overtime period. It's going to go to MADELL. They'll link up, and Ryan doesn't see it coming from that backside. Roberts accepts that he's in position, and he just veers off. And you watch MADELL a little bit. I wouldn't say he's casual, but he seems pretty relaxed in these moments. And with what's at stake, that is impressive. Hunting from behind, trying to just ram his man into a place where maybe he can control him. It's effectively a handoff to the last runner in a 4-by-1. That's what you just saw there from Ryan into the lap of Roberts. But it's BHUTA who will reload. And now the chant of defense coming out from the Canadian support inside Carioca number 1 arena. BHUTA has done it well again, the contact on the arm. Are they just going to count the point, or are they going to send the Canadian to the penalty box? Looks as though here at the moment they're just going to allow that to be a score. So they've been pretty good, in fairness, the officials so far in the tournament, and have allowed the game to really just settle itself and the teams to do so. There's just going to be the one mistake in it here. The Canadians ahead, as you can see by the 1 point right now. So as we say, overtime number 1. They'll both have a chance, as that's what's been scheduled. And leaving the field of play, it's a timeout has been called, and looks as though it's BHUTA who was the closest man to the referee. WHITEHEAD looking a little bit tired, and he'll just draw a breath. So inside the last minute here now, we'll just have a look officially at the system timeout. It is BHUTA for a 30-second one. And what drama. The pressure on GB to try to level before the end of it. Roberts into a tight place. They've got BHUTA open. So he puts it back, and we're at 49 strong. So the official system, as we understood it, we would go to 2 3-minute periods. And then from there, after you play the two, then it comes down to just one period after each other. And that is how it has been put in the books prior to this one. So officially on our system, it's the overtime one. So that looks to be on course, as right now MADELL is holding on to this ball, and he elects to call a timeout with 14 seconds on the scoring clock. And equally, just trying to remember back who inbounded to start this overtime period. It'll be each side, but who gets the second one? We'll find out, obviously, in a moment, too. But the timeout taken by Canada. And this is becoming breathless stuff. Hope you're enjoying it, wherever you're watching. This really is as good as it gets in wheelchair rugby. Hirschfield into MADELL. Roberts will just go back and hold. He'll watch on the other side of this formation. He's going to throw the brakes on. He knows he's in trouble. He's got two Brits on him. The feed inside to Hirschfield. He'll go across the line. And is that going to be the drama, though, that they need? As it could be. So we'll just wait for clarity about this one. And are they going to record it? But this is the question here now. And I'm not sure that it's just quite done yet. That's a great play. You hear the celebrations. And the consolations do come in. They just have the one overtime period here. As you're watching both sides, a little bit confused by it. But it is going to be the Canadian result in Group A action right at the end of play as they settle out. And sorry for the confusion, but that was how it has been brought forward. It's a 3-minute extra time period, and the Canadians right at the end find the drama, find their moment, and MADELL, who was in and amongst it, saves them from the brink of failure before going into overtime, and again with the master stroke at the end. So it is just the one overtime, and if they are tied, of course they would keep going, but they find a way, and Canada from the jaws of defeat, they pull themselves a victory. And you see a moment there of true respect and appreciation for each other. It's 30 goals in the end for what has been a tremendous test. It was Great Britain who fell to Australia by 2. This one is going to be tough to overcome. There you see the look on Jim Roberts' face. This is his first Paralympic Games competing for Great Britain. They were 5th 4 years ago in London, and they came as close as you would want to come without getting it. A couple defeats in the preliminary round, it's going to leave you really hard-pressed to come through this group. And I suggested maybe it's the group of death. Well, somebody was going to go down in this one. And we went to extra time, and it looked as though we were going to go to another period, and just in the nick, with 0.7 seconds left, Canada escaped what could have been a very slippery path for them indeed, that would have sent them into a goals for and against differential, and more fingers than I have to count to figure out just how the math was going to settle in this one. But it really was a fantastically played matchup and a heartbreaker. I'm gutted for Great Britain. They really deserve a little bit better. It's a tough one to take, as Canada will come through and they'll just get that 1-point victory. They get to a half century first. As I said earlier on in the match, you only need to have the lead just once, and Canada had it just in the nick of time before a full 35 minutes had been played. The entire scoring setup of the leaders in this match, MADELL and Roberts, they really counteract each other. But this, the reflection of the turnovers, the Canadians still commit one more. But really, it just comes down to game management, and I can still hardly believe what happened there. It was just that last play by MADELL before going to overtime, and there the full time score. 5-4, the victory in overtime comes to the Canadians, and the total full-time result, 50-49. And this is now how the group will shape out. So a couple games have been played. That isn't quite the story in this one. Canada now with two victories. They will sit atop with four. Australia still yet to play.